Hey, welcome everybody to Philipse Manor Hall. I want to welcome you out here to Time Chat, brought to you by CNN, the Colonial News Network. Yeah, it's a really big shoe here, I got to tell you. You're in for a good treat because my name is Ben Thayer, and I am the host of this program. And today, our premise, if you haven't been aware of Time Chat before, is to bring people of the past together to discuss their lives, their issues, the causes, and where they were at that particular time period. When we're back to Time Chat after a brief hiatus, if you had seen our last episode, we had a little bit of difficulty when we invited and brought together New York Yankees catcher, famed catcher Yogi Berra, with a Time Chat with Jellystone's very famous Yogi Bear. Didn't go down as well as I expected. I really thought that bear was cute and tame, but that's another story. Today on Time Chat, today is July 29th. It's the 210th day of the year. In the news, the only thing I have to say is that the writer's strike is in its 12th week, and this will show, simply because I am now left with handwritten notes. Our cue card intern has walked off the set, but we're not crossing any picket lines today. I am happy to report that our sign associate is still here. I'll introduce Miss Dawn That. Miss Dawn That is our sign associate. She is going to help you figure out whether or not you should boo or hiss or applaud or laugh or cheer or gasp. Because she's very good with all of this. So we'll have an example here. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm introducing our associate, Dawn That. Very good. We're old pros at this. We've been doing this forever now. It's been an eventful day. Today being July the 29th, let me go over a couple of dates in history. What happened on this day in the year 362? Since none of us in this room was there. Emperor Julianus of Constantinople prohibits Christian teachers from using pagan literature and text for teaching classical education. Sound, yeah, ooh. I don't have an ooh sign, but we have a gasp sign. Yeah, I wonder if Julianus has retired to Florida or not. The year 1588, the English fleet scatters the invincible, so-called invincible, Spanish armada in the Battle of Gravelines, forcing the Spanish to make this long and costly retreat, and basically securing England and the island of the British Isles for the English in 1588. Yay, all right, thank you. In 1957, The Tonight Show premieres on NBC. Who was the host? Who was the first host of The Tonight Show? Jack Parr, exactly. I only say that because I don't have a sidekick, and I don't have a band. But I do have Miss Dawn That, though, so she's very helpful with that. And in 1981, Prince Charles, now King Charles III, married Lady Diana Spencer. Very lavish ceremony at St. Paul's Cathedral in London. We all thought that one was a keeper, right? Sometimes the times change. But, oh, look. Something relevant to our show. On this day in 1805, the French philosopher and historian Alexis de Tocqueville was born. We all know old Alexis de Tocqueville, right? Sure, best remembered for writing Democracy in America, de Tocqueville's analysis of American democracy. It remains somewhat relevant today and widely studied because, you know, I was just quoting from de Tocqueville the other day. So we all know about Alexis. But anyway, it would be nice to get de Tocqueville on the show, though. Maybe do an episode of Time Chat with Emperor Julianus, get some conversation going. So anyway, let's move on to today's show. What do we got going on today? For today's episode, we are exploring the roles of loyalists and patriots in New York during the American Revolution. Now, there are some audience rules before I bring out our guests. Please remember that they are persons from the past. In general, they were New York residents who have chosen to side in the American Revolution, one side or the other. As you can see, we have King George III and George Washington up there to tell you that they're on one side or the other. As for the date, let's going to keep that a little blurry. It's been almost 250 years, and they're not going to remember it anyway. But the war has been raging in this part of Westchester at least for 5 long years at this point. Whether a patriot or a loyalist, this war has been a terrible and tragic aspect of life for these men and women. Lives have been lost, families have been separated and torn apart, and it's hard to imagine the hardship and fear of what might be next for these New Yorkers. Most of Westchester County, that most of us are living in, was little more than a no man's land. We're fighting between the British Army just south of us in Manhattan and the American forces just north up near Putnam County. We're constantly clashing in this area. Our guests don't have the luxury of knowing what's going to happen next in this war or what the outcome of this war is going to be. And I'm going to try not to spoil it for them. I'm hoping that this will be a no-spoiler zone for all of us here. Both sides, though, whether Loyalist or Patriot, will have permission to speak freely and express their opinions, which means this could lead to some disagreements. I hope nobody brought cabbages or anything else to toss at the crowd, and I'm going to make sure that these guys didn't bring any either. But I don't expect it to devolve into this violent spectacle that we had in one of our previous episodes, Goth or Visigoth. That was a tough one. If possible, please refrain from too many modern references with our guests arrived. They've been prepared for these cameras, for lights, for microphones and being on sound and such. But for God's sakes, please silence your telephones, lest any of us are accused of speaking with the devil or being witches. All right, we don't want to have that happen either here. So allow me to introduce today's guests. Our first guest is a New Englander born into the wealthy Flucker family. Her Loyalist family is now at odds with their daughter and her husband, Continental Army officer Henry Knox. Please welcome Miss Lucy Flucker Knox. Woo-hoo. Miss Knox. Thank you. Now, he's the local militiaman who, along with two others, stopped and questioned Major Andre in Tarrytown, leading to the confiscation and plans of his arrest. Please welcome Mr. David Williams. Mr. Williams, if you could relinquish your weapon, I guess, if you could very well, we can bring that over to Miss That. Thank you very much. He's a native New Yorker and something of a firebrand, mind you, who has risen to the rank of captain in General Washington's army. Please welcome Captain Gershom Mott. Captain Mott, if we could have your sword, or if Miss That could. Thank you very much. We are a nonviolent talk show today. She's an enslaved woman, privy to information from both her enslaver, American spy Mr. Robert Townsend, and British Colonel John Simcoe. All the way from Oyster Bay, Long Island, please welcome Elizabeth. Now he's a native of Maryland, of the Pocomoke people, who were forced to relocate and settled first in northeastern Pennsylvania and now out near Oswego, New York. Please welcome Paketawas Makatawau, also known as Black Corn. Mr. Corn, if it could be arranged that we could have your weapons stored safely.
Why should I allow you to take my gun?
Well, we have agreed to keep this as peaceful as possible, and should any arguments occur, we just wish to keep things safe. Mm. Thank you, sir. And Ms. That can take that as well. And take your seat. She's a former resident here of Philipse Manor Hall, one of the wealthiest residents in New York. She's married to British Army officer Colonel Roger Morris. And back here at her old stomping grounds for the first time in years, welcome Ms. Mary Philipse Morris. Madam. Okay. Very well. And as our last seat in the house here, here's a dashing British officer recently captured in Tarrytown by a group of American militiamen, including Mr. Williams here, who had found plans dealing with the handover of West Point to the British. On leave from his prison cell in Tappan, New York, welcome Major John Andre. Sorry. Plenty of time. So ladies and gentlemen upon the stage here, welcome. I appreciate your time. Each of you here has a very compelling story, and I have invited you here to share your experiences with our studio audience today. There are no secrets here. You may consider the guest sitting to your left or to your right or across the aisle to be your enemy. And you may hear information today that may even change the advantage from one army to another. But you have agreed, I hope you have agreed, not to share what you hear today. For the purpose of this program, what happens at Philipse Manor Hall will stay at Philipse Manor Hall. I also wish to thank you for consenting to leave your weapons backstage or with Miss That. I confess that I was a little taken aback that so many of your weapons were primed and loaded and ready. However, we will return to them after our interns will get them to you. Now, let us begin today's program. You may take your seats, ladies and gentlemen. I would like if each of you, and we'll begin perhaps with Lucy Knox to my left, I would like each of you to begin with a little bit of a background for our audience today. If you could, Ms. Knox, share something with about who you are, where your loyalties lie, and what you are presently doing now during this terrible time of war.
Sure, Mr. Thayer, I'd be happy to share. My name is Lucy Knox, and I am the wife of the one and only Major General Henry Knox. Originally hailing from Boston, I was forced to flee in 1775 and have been a vagabond ever since. I have lived in Massachusetts, Connecticut, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and now most recently New York. I do not have a home of my own, but I, sir, am a patriot.
Mr. David Williams, we'll continue with your introduction.
Well, sir, my name is David Williams. I was born at Philipsburg Manor, just north of here in Tarrytown. My father was a tenant farmer, and I was a tenant farmer up until July 4, 1775, when I enlisted in the Continental Army in the 4th New York Regiment. I served during the Canadian Expedition, went as far as Fort St. John, was discharged, came back, and served in the Westchester County Militia, which is where I presently am. Came back to my home, was told that I was not welcome there, and am now living with neighbors who are also in the militia, and presently I'm escorting this gentleman over to my right for his final fate.
Indeed. Captain Mott, what say you?
My name is Captain Gershom Mott of the 2nd Continental Artillery Regiment. I've spent much of the war stationed here in the Hudson Highlands between New Windsor, New York, and Morristown, New Jersey. I participated in the construction of West Point, and over this winter, spent much of the winter in New Windsor training with the Continental Artillery, preparing for the upcoming campaign season.
Thank you. Miss Elizabeth, or Liss, is it?
My name is Elizabeth, and my friends and family call me Liss. I live in Oyster Bay, Long Island. I am an enslaved woman with the Townsend household. My master, Robert Townsend, he was a member of George Washington's Culper spy ring. I also escaped to Manhattan, and while I was there, I also would pass secrets to Robert Townsend as well.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Mr. Korn.
Natalo and si pagdawas magdawi pagmoch tanapin ng pelino ne.
I'm not sure how many of us actually speak your language, Mr. Korn. Do you happen to be able to speak in English?
Yes, I spent much time with the Moravian missionaries who taught me English, and so I can speak that language for you if you wish.
Thank you. That would be nice.
I'm called Black Korn, a Pokemoke person. I am. I was born at a place called Askaminakansen, what the English call Askaminakansen. It was once a great Indian town in your colony of Maryland. Our people call it Askamokasen, which means the pitching boat village. It is a beautiful place with deep black water, cypress trees, and good flat land for planting. In 1742, the colony of Maryland decided to abolish this town, and many of our people made a choice. Some of us chose to stay in our homelands, where we have been told that many of them have intermarried with the free Africans and many with the poor whites who have settled in that place. But some of those people, my family included, went with the Nantigoch to southeastern Pennsylvania, where we stayed for a time. Won the Axe War in 1763 changed many things, and Pennsylvania no longer became a good place for us to live. And so we went with the Nantigoch to Oswego, and I live now in a town of Nantigoch and Oswego people, and Nantigoch and Pocomoc people at Oswego.
Major Andre.
I am Major John Andre, spy master to His Majesty's Royal Army. I am not in my regimentals through a mishap during the plot to sell West Point from General Benedict Arnold. I was captured by this gentleman and his miscreant cohorts. And now I await my sentencing in Japan.
Indeed. And Mary Philipse Morris, ma'am.
Yes, Mr. Thayer. Welcome, everyone, to my brother's house. We Philipses has been in New York for over 100 years. I currently live in New York City, although I have been driven from my home at Mount Morris, up at the top of the island, and also from our properties in the Highland Patent. But my husband, Colonel Roger Morris, has returned to me from England. And so my family is together at last.
Indeed. Well, thank you for those introductions, my illustrious guests. Yes, we can applaud if we wish. Let me begin with Mr. Blackcorn. The war, Mr. Corn, did not impact just your life, but really the lives of all the Pocomoc. And how did you, as a native of Maryland, with your people, find yourself all the way in upstate New York? And with the current war that is raging now, have your people chosen one side or the other, or are they remaining neutral in this war?
We come a chowchick Doug Wasson. Good words spoken aloud. These are good questions to ask. And so for our people, we have lived in your colony of Maryland for time immemorial. And up till recently, in the days of my father and my grandfather, our times were good. But the colony of Maryland became greedy. They wanted more of our planting land in the flatlands, which they now call the Eastern Shore. And they wanted these lands to farm on, and so many of our people were forced to leave with their Nantucket kin. And so for a long time, we stayed in southeastern Pennsylvania. We stayed there with the Deutsch people and the Moravian people. We learned many things from them. We shared food with them, and we learned their language and their Jesus, and we learned Deutsch from them. But after the Axe War, it was no longer, when the colony of Pennsylvania said that all the Indians, if they were not Christianized, they must leave, that they must go either to the Ohio country or they must go away, they must go to the north. And so for those of us who did not accept Jesus into our hearts, we had to leave. And so the Nantigoch, we were told there was land for us. Sir William Johnston came to our people and he said there was land for us that we could live at Oswego. And so we went there and we carried the bones of our dead and we went to Oswego when Pennsylvania was no longer good for us to live in. It is hard for us to decide who to fight for. There are some communities that say we should not fight at all. This is a war between father and son. And it has nothing to do with us, and we shall go and hunt and fish and trap at Lake Ontario, and we shall go to the land of the Anishinaabe, the Ojibwe. We shall go there with the Sauk and Fox, and we shall go live there away from these troubles. Some of our people have said, who have accepted Jesus into their hearts, they see themselves as brothers and kin to these settlers. Some of them have married into their families, have children who are intermarried with their families, and they have said we should fight with them, and that their General Washington and their other people have told them, especially Sukima White Eyes of the Delaware, they have told Sukima White Eyes that if the Indian people decide to fight for the colonists, they decide to fight for the rebels, that they shall make them a 14th state in this great union they wish to create. But I and others believe that these colonists will lie. These are the same colonists who have called us friend and called us brother, but then we go into their towns during this war, and they lock their doors. They hold their children tight, and they would not even give us the ash from their pipes to smoke. And so many of our people, myself, other young warriors,
war captains and some chiefs have listened to the words of Tyon the Nega, Joseph Brandt, who has gone to many villages and gone to many councils. And he has said if we fight for the great father of the English, that the great father of the English will honor his treaties. He will honor his words, and he will make the young, his younger brothers, his children, these colonists, he will make them listen. And the father shall speak to the son, and the son shall listen, and he shall uphold his end of the wampum belt, and he shall honor these agreements that he has made with his with their Indian brothers. And they shall honor those agreements and let the Indian people have country of their own to live on. That's all we ask. You stay on the lands that you live on. You have raised your family, your corn, and your cattle, but do not take more, and do not take what does not belong to you. And so some of us believe if we fight for the great father of the English, such as the Haudenosaunee have decided, many of them have decided, that it will be better for us, and that we will be able to protect more of our lands.
Hmm. But if I may, Mr. Corn, you had mentioned earlier that you had originally begun to move to Pennsylvania and to settle there, and then that colony had decided that you did not feel welcome in that colony and had to move. During that time, wasn't Pennsylvania also a colony under King George? And was it not the Pennsylvanians under the colony?
They refused to listen to the words of their father.
I see.
These sons did not wish to listen to the words of their father. These Scots-Irishmen, they came and they destroyed the village of the Susquehannocks. The Susquehannocks who believed in Jesus like they believed in Jesus. And they came while their men, their women, and children were asleep. And they killed them. They put them into a church and lit it on fire. They told us even if they looked at us and they said, even though you may not have told us that you sided with Wondiak, with Pontiac of the Odawa, that you may have not fought with him or believed what he had said, all Indians are guilty. The Deitch people did not want us to leave. The Deitch people continue to call us their friends and their brothers. But it was the Scots. It was the Irish. It was many of them who wished us to go. And many of them who the Deitch people and some of the English people could not control, they refused to listen to their brothers. And many of these same Scots and Irishmen fight with these Americans, and they call themselves Patriots. These same people who would go into our villages and burn our towns, burn our cornfields, slaughter our men, women, and children.
Ms. Knox, you've listened to Mr. Corn. He mentions that this war is a war between father and son, between family members, between the English and their colonists. You come from a very wealthy and prominent Boston family who are, in fact, avowed loyalists. So how on earth did a woman of your background become such a strong supporter of the Patriot cause?
Well, Mr. Thayer, there is only one word that could possibly come to mind, and it's love. See, I was in Boston Common one day, and there was a parade, and there was this lieutenant at the head of the militia grenadiers, and he was tall and handsome with enchanting gray eyes, and I had to know who he was. So I started asking around, and I found out he ran a small bookstore, and I said, well, perhaps they sell books I like. So I went and I checked them out. I read, I write, why not? And I started talking with him, and it was as if Eros himself had shot me through the heart. I just could not look away. And the more I talked with him and his friends, Nathaniel Green used to come, and I would hear them, and they would talk about this cause. It lit a fire inside me. And I loved this man, and even though my dad was a crown appointed official who leaves me behind and says, forget it. I disown you. I will not come to your wedding. I will not write to you. I chose love, and I've been on the road ever since.
Mrs. Morris.
Yes, Mr.
Mrs. Knox chose love for her, and that split her apart from her family. But I wish to think back a ways, because rumor has it that there was a former rebel commander by a young Lieutenant George Washington, who was smitten with you a number of years back when you were not married.
He yes,
apparently held a flame for you.
Story, right?
Yes, we are curious to know.
Much younger, 2 years younger than I, in fact. Young lieutenant, quite tall. Some would call him handsome. A very good dancer. But No real family background, a bit rough and tumble. No land to speak of, no house. Virginia militiamen, yes. Hero of Monongahela, debatable. But unfortunately for Mr. Washington, one of his compatriots had caught my eye. Another lieutenant colonel, but in the British Army, aide-de-camp to General Braddock. That is how they knew each other. They also knew my brother-in-law, Beverly Robinson, also of the Virginia militia. But Roger is a true gentleman. Third son, yes, but of a very well-born English family. And it was he who caught my eye. And trust me, I was 28 when we married. I took my time deciding. And of course, a year after we married, almost to the day, Mr. Washington found himself another very wealthy woman to marry, another older wealthy woman. So I think we can draw some conclusions about his proclivities from that. I'm sure they're very happy together. I know Roger and I certainly are very happy together.
As a close friend of Mrs. Washington, I can say he chose wisely.
I'm sure they are very happy together.
And whose land does Mrs. Washington live on? Accomack land. And she took that land from the Accomack people. Does she give land back to the Gengoskins?
She took nothing.
That's debatable.
So I had heard, Mrs. Morris, that it was George Washington, in fact, that signed the papers for your act of attainder. That has now, you have now been... Yes, you have been accused of treason against the new government of New York.
Right. A little ironic, don't you think, that the people who are rising up against the established government that gave them so much, that they are not the treasonous ones, and in fact, anyone who opposes them is a traitor? I find that ironic in the extreme. And, you know, I also find it interesting that the act of attainder really only applies to large, wealthy landowners, so I doubt it actually has much to do with our loyalties, and rather with the size of our real estate.
Hmm. Well, speaking of your real estate, Mr. Williams. Mr. Williams is a former tenant of the Philipses for generations, I believe, on that land that you rented from them. Was your choice to join the Patriot cause related in any way with your knowledge that your loyalists, your landlords were loyalists rather than Patriots?
Well, sir, it would far be it for me to say so, but part of it was that. Even leading up to the first shots of the war being fired, there were plenty of pamphleteers in this area that were sending out pamphlets supporting the king and pamphlets supporting us rebelling against the king. And I, although I'm not one to read and write, these were read to me. And I have to say that the thought of being able to live my own life without having to pay somebody to just exist did intrigue me. That along with the fact that I knew how my life was set out. I had a very basic routine. I knew what I had to do every day. And the thought of enlisting in the Continental Service did intrigue me. Indeed, I got to see places far beyond where I grew up and I lived and would have expected to see if I stayed here otherwise.
Can you give us something of a report on the state of tenant farmers in Westchester currently during this war? Is it true that both armies and their aligned militia units, such as yours, are continually harassing farmers, taking cattle, crops, and firewood, and threatening anyone who is not on the side of the soldiers who knock on their door that day?
Well, that indeed is true, sir. Again, we've been typified as skinners, those who support the Patriot cause, whereas our counterparts who support the king are known as cowboys. Our main job here is to disrupt the flow of supplies going into New York City, which is currently occupied by those of the lower part of the state, those being the British. And yes, the current state of things, because of this back and forth, seems to be a high level of anxiety. Indeed, we don't really know who our friends and neighbors are anymore unless we basically convince them or we threaten them. And that's part of the process, as you'll find out. You know, there may be intrigues. For example, with Mr. Andre, you don't really know who is who. So these things are required, and it does cause a high level of anxiety here.
Major Andre, sir, I mean, of all my guests today, I know your time is the most precious. I should thank you for spending one of your last days on Earth here with us. Could you tell us something of how an individual, a mild-mannered tenant farmer such as Mr. Williams here, had managed to outsmart you?
How dare you, sir? Outsmart? He was nearly the wrong side of a coin, I chose. Besides, one of them was wearing a Hessian coat.
Half our army is dressed in captured British coats.
That's true.
And what does that say about your army, sir? Mm.
That they're better than yours.
This is not a hero of a revolution. This is but a ruffian, a band of ruffians out to rob anyone who had the misfortune of coming across them on the post road.
Thank you for the buckles, sir.
Your blunder, Major Andre, suggests some questionable judgment on your part. How did you manage to be in Tarrytown in the middle of this no man's land?
I was meant to be picked up by the ship I arrived from New York City on. I was meant to be picked up by the Vulture. The Vulture was fired upon while I was meeting with Benedict Arnold. And the Vulture, yes, you may guess. I certainly did when the Vulture turned around and headed towards the city.
A very fine piece of work by Lieutenant Colonel Livingston, firing on the Vulture.
My traitorous cousins.
I was given the option of trading my regimental coat for civilian clothes and to make my way back to New York City through the wilds of Westchester County. I was merely reacting to a very dynamic situation, one that we had not prepared for. It was a flawless plan with a slight flaw.
Is that how it went down, Mr. Williams?
Well, sir, like all great moments in history, this seemed to just happen through no fault in being at the right place at the right time, I suppose. I was convalescing at home, and I was asked by some of my compatriots in the local militia to go after not Mr. Andre, but another gentleman and his gang who had just burned down my neighbor's barn and home. And here walks up in the middle of broad day this fine gentleman in his fine clothes, and he asks us, are we of the upper sort, meaning those who support the Congress, or those of the lower sort, those who support the king? And we said, we are of the upper sort. And with that, he said, okay, great. And he trusted us. Well, I could say for a fact that although I am of very low make, and although I am not as fancily dressed as that gentleman there, I could spot a bad actor when I sees one.
Oh, please, if your compatriot couldn't read, you never would have known.
Well, sir, I know we can't read, but we could certainly see that there is a map there, a map with fortifications drawn upon it, and that's all we needed to seize.
And you were under a flag of truce and violating the rules of a flag of truce. Your fate should be the same as the King's forces gave Captain Hale.
I have nothing to say to that.
Captain Hale, too.
You won't have much more to say.
My Henry will see to it.
There seems to be quite a bit of spying activity that we are talking about here, much more so than even the battles of the war. I am surprised at how much this spying has been going on both sides of the war as well. But let me get to one point that I'm curious about, because this notion, Mary Philipse Morris, of treason, and treason by a new form of a government here, it's a very serious offense, and it is certainly punishable through execution. And both sides of this conflict have had plenty of treason on each end, Major Andre, as well as Nathan Hale. Miss Knox, you've known General Benedict Arnold socially for apparently a number of years. He's accused of conspiring with Major Andre and the British military to hand over the fort at West Point. Can you tell us a little about your relationship with Benedict Arnold?
Benedict Arnold. Well, this brings up pain and a lot of fury. You see, he could have very well delivered my Henry to the hands of death. So for that, I will forever hate his name. I will not address him by a title. He will just be Benedict. Anyway, you see, he had met a woman while he was in Boston, and, well, she happened to be a friend of mine. Her name was Betsy, but as I tell you the story, please know that Betsy is 15. He's greater than 15, and then some. Anyway, so he fell smitten with Betsy, and he decided he would send her a ring. He sent her a trunk of expensive dresses, and eventually she said, no thank you, sir, and spurned his advances. Well, one thing that Benedict didn't take into account was the fact that she's a loyalist. So she sent him on his way. I mean, to describe him, he's short. He's nowhere near as tall as my Henry, so I could have passed him over. Good build, darker complexion, light blue eyes, but still, nothing wonderful. Anyway, so back to the trunk of dresses, because that's the point of interest. So I have this trunk that's supposed to be returned. Why not check it out? See if there's anything for me inside. So Mrs. Green, Kitty, my good friend and I, we decided to open it up and try on a few things. Kitty being smaller than I, she found a beautiful dress that fit her like a glove. I had to settle for a scarf, but lovely nonetheless. And when we were out to Benedict, he said, no, you may not keep them. Please put them back in the trunk. I will deal with it when I come to Boston. Well then, sir. Anyway, I will always consider him to be a traitor, but there is a small piece of my heart that will always be thankful for delivering my child and I safely to my Henry in Valley Forge.
Thank you, Miss Knox. Liss, another individual here of intrigue and spying. I know that you may be familiar with Major John Andre and also John Simcoe. Tell me a little bit about your life and those experiences between both Patriots and the Loyalists that crossed your threshold at the Townsend House.
All right. So during the war, I was in the Townsend household with about 18 other enslaved people, and the John Simcoe's regiment, the officers, they took over the Townsend household. So in addition to the Townsend family and the about 19 enslaved people, we now had British officers living with us, and I was also serving them as well. So I had the interesting experience of serving both the Patriots and the British. And while I do feel some loyalty to the Townsends, it's because they are all I know. I have lived there, I was born in this household. However, when John Andre and John Simcoe were in this household, they were abolitionists, and they believed in freeing the slaves. And John Simcoe actually helped me to escape. But most importantly, they spoke to me like I was a human. They spoke to me as a person. And it was said that I was a little too friendly with them, but I enjoyed the conversations that I had with them because they could speak to me and look me in the eye as another human being. So, although I did appreciate their friendship of the British, in my way, I was also loyal to the Patriots, because the devil you know is often better than the devil that you don't know.
I certainly can understand your point, yet you still, yes, you choose to sit under the sign of George Washington and the Patriot cause, yet are you familiar with the document that the British commander, Sir Henry Clinton, issued here in this household called the Philipsburg Proclamation, which promised to free any enslaved individual of a rebel should they find their way to British lines in New York, which you certainly had been in New York. Yet you still choose to say loyal to the Patriots.
Yes, yes. As I said, the Townsends, they were everything that I knew. I knew this is all that I knew. And I, as Mr. Korn would say, I don't know if trust is something that I could do, but I had hope. I had hope that after giving my service, my participation for what would soon be, you know, a new country, that perhaps I would be given my freedom. But this is where my family lived. My mother, my sister, my other families in town. This is all that I knew, so this is where I chose my loyalties to stay.
Captain Mott, you've made a choice to rebel against the crown from very early on, as far as I understand, as far back as more than a decade ago when you joined or founded the New York chapter of the Sons of Liberty. Why such an early decision to rebel against the crown?
I would say the crown sought to levy taxes against the colonists, not for illegitimate reasons to fund the war, but the method and that they went about it is the issue, that they sought to tax us without us having proper representation that would be granted to free Englishmen. When they rebuffed the our colonial representatives who were sent to them and continued those to levy those taxes, I realized earlier than some, such as Mr. Franklin, that action would have to be taken. One could say some of this action could be hooliganism.
I'll say.
But one man's hooliganism, when you have no other option, becomes a different man's legitimate form of protest.
Oh, please. Please, why are you clapping for that? It's cudgel boys like him that are the reason my Roger had to leave for fear of his life, beating people up in the streets, tarring and feathering people. It's disgraceful.
Hopefully your Roger will have to leave even further.
Well, he's back now. No thanks to you lot.
But Captain, those you spoke of taxes being unjust and not being represented in Parliament, but weren't many of those taxes levied simply as an effort for the Crown to pay the costs against the French and their native partners in the last war? Wasn't England also defending the colonies against the French and the Spanish? And shouldn't it be allowed that Parliament can levy taxes in forms of the protection of the colonies?
William Pitt would disagree with you. He actually spoke of England's actions taking freedom and making it a crime. And that is why his statue still stands and the king's statue no longer does. Yes, England could have raised funds by moving through our colonial assemblies and our elected representatives or granting us representation in the House of Commons, but I believe they feared us being granted that representation.
Well, we will continue this conversation. I'd like to actually continue this with Mrs. Knox, because I know, Mrs. Knox, you've spent much of this war moving from camp to camp. You've been in many of the different colonies. You've stayed in other people's houses. You've lived essentially far below your aristocratic upbringing. Are you ready for this fighting to end so you can return to your high standard of living, or has this war changed your opinions on the disparity of wealth between the upper classes and the laboring classes?
Well, to answer the first question, I was ready for the war to be over about 10 minutes into it. This has been a very trying few years. Children born in different states, children buried in different states. I am ready to settle down once and for all. I think that we will never obtain the level of wealth my family had. I don't envision having the South Street townhouse, servants, imported goods, all of the finer things I once knew. But I will have my Henry, and that is the most important thing to me. As for the classes, I think that they will always exist. I think there will always be rich, there will always be poor, and there will always be those trapped within the middle. But I see a way that all can work together. I'm hopeful.
Very well. Mrs. Morris.
Yes,
I haven't noticed. I mean, there is you pitted on one side under the king, and you, Mrs. Knox, on the other side under George Washington. Yet, as a wealthy patriot or a wealthy loyalist, I don't see much difference between the two of you. Mrs. Morris, if the loyalist cause wins in this war, what will change with your family?
Good question. Well, I certainly hope that we would be able to return to our estates, and thankfully, most of them are in good British army hands, so they haven't been burned or pillaged like some of the other places of my compatriots. It is difficult to answer, Mr. Thayer. There is much animosity between the two sides, and there has been much bloodshed. I do not know what the end result will be. I should hope that the British army would prevail and that His Royal Highness would remain our sovereign, but forgiveness does not come easily to some people, and I do not know what the end result would be. I certainly know what the Patriots will do to us, as they have already tried to do it with their act of attainder. I do not know if the loyal Americans would do the same.
Miss Captain Mott, do you think that General Washington is the right man to lead the Patriot soldiers to victory when all he seems to be doing is retreating his way through New Jersey twice?
General Washington is a capable commander who's held an army together under difficult conditions that no European commander could ever achieve. Though he may be prone to overly complicated plans on the battlefield, his capability of holding an army together under difficult conditions with lack of supply and competing factions can't be matched by anyone. He has capable field commanders in the form of Nathaniel Greene, General Greene, and General Wayne. So I believe he is the right man to lead the army.
Major Andre, would you do this again? Would you sacrifice for king and country in a place 1,000 miles from your home? Would you sacrifice your life for such a thing again?
Earlier we brought up this American spy, Nathaniel, Nathan Hale. And I will paraphrase him, that I regret that I have but one life to give to my country.
Indeed, those powerful words. I would like to ask you and others around this table as well what you think of the Continental Congress's recent Declaration of Independence issued just a few years earlier. And I'm especially interested in your opinion of the following statement in this document. It's a very powerful statement written, I believe, by Mr. Thomas Jefferson. And that statement says, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness."
I think Miss Elizabeth might have something to say.
You think Miss Elizabeth may say something of this? Miss
Liss. Yes, yes. Those words, I'm sure they're very pretty, but they don't say anything about my people who are enslaved. What is this truth, happiness, pursuit of, and so on? That's not offered to me. So what does that mean for me?
Well, indeed, and it does beg the question as to whether you wish to remain with your former master, with the Townsend family, unless you, there is a reason for you to be at the Townsends. It perplexes me as to why, if you call into doubt the document that was signed by these 56 American patriots, yet you question the validity of that, and yet you stay with the Patriot cause.
I absolutely, well, I stay because at least I know them. But when it comes to these words of people that I don't know writing these what is the word, platitudes, I don't believe them. And I don't necessarily believe anything on the other side that the Patriots would be saying anything, excuse me, the British would be saying anything different. I believe that they will say whatever they believe that they can say and get away with in order to change other people's minds. But as far as I'm concerned, I'm either going to be an enslaved person here or I'm going to be an enslaved person there. So it doesn't really matter, so I'm going to stay with the people I know.
The British Army keeps its promises, unlike some.
Is that like the promise to pick up Major Andre, or? It's an honest question.
I will not dignify that with a response.
That was not dishonesty, that was misfortune.
And speaking of honesty, you speak of the different classes of people. Where do the Indian people lie? Would you accept me living next to you in your home? Would you accept me living there? Would you consider me your brother and your friend, or would you call me brother, and then I leave and you take more of our land? You take more of our country. We are fine with you living where you live, raising your corn and your family where you are, but take no more. This document, though, may have good words in it and good feelings and good heart that's put into it, but where do the Indian people lie? We know that we see and talk to our brothers who have Christianized. We have talked to the Stockbridge. We have talked to the Nantigo. We have talked to the Moravian people. And they do not speak kind words of you. And though you call them Christian brothers, you do not treat them as brothers.
Well, I think the way that you are generalizing the colonists is the same way that the colonists generalize all Native Americans. I don't think that it makes a difference. I have lived at the top of society, and I have lived at the very bottom of society.
No, you have not.
I cannot say either way, but I welcome all into my home and will continue to do so.
Even me?
Even you.
We'll Ms. see. Knox.
I must interrupt momentarily. I do believe that Native people are mentioned in that document.
And what does those words say?
It's not nice.
No. It is not nice.
No, perhaps Captain Mott can enlighten us.
What of Stone Arabia, German Flats, Schoharie, and those attacks along the frontier? I would say there is a lot of brutality in the frontier warfare by both sides.
I do know that the war has caused a tremendous amount of loss within a variety of the Native American communities. I know that the previous wars did the same under the various other kings while these were colonies. I did want to mention something. Ms. Knox, you honor this document by saying that things will turn out right and that these words are words that we should look forward to of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But I should remind everybody
Whose
here...
happiness?
Well, of these 56 signers, Mr. Korn, of our Declaration of Independence, I should point out that 40 of them are slave owners themselves. And of those 40 who are slave owners, a member who was the president of the Continental Congress at the time, Mr. John Hancock of Boston, who you know very well, was a slaveholder. There is a man here in Pennsylvania named Benjamin Franklin, who was also a slaveholder. And that there are 9 names here representing all of the delegates to New York and New Jersey who signed this document. And of those 9 members, all of them were slaveholders as well. I do feel I need to point this out to you, Ms. Knox, especially, in that this document may not be worth the paper that it is written on. And I want to also mention on the Loyalist side that the document of the Philipsburg Proclamation has caused thousands of enslaved individuals to run to British lines in pursuit of their freedom as well. Just to fill in the rest of the story here, folks.
Well said.
Now, before we get to the end of our program, I do want to honor our guests by asking them a simple question. It may not be quite as simple as we think, but I do want to ask them, with the war raging as it is, I want to ask, where do you think this war is, where do you think we are headed towards the end of this war, and where will you be at the end of this war? How will this war have affected you, and how do you think this war will end? Let's begin with Miss Morris.
Well, it's difficult to say. I hope that our Crown forces are victorious, and that I can return with my children and Roger to Mount Morris, our beloved home. And I hope that we would have another 100 years of peace and prosperity as we did in the first 100 years of my family's living here in New York.
Will this change your relationship with your tenant farmers?
Well, sir, we have very loyal tenant farmers for the most part. Some of them even came to New York City to pay rent to my brother Frederick.
Better without them.
I'm sorry?
We're better without them.
Oh, well, you might think that. You might think that. Wait until there is some kind of natural disaster and we'll see how you do without our help. But it is difficult to say. As I said earlier, there is much animosity on both sides, but I like to think that peace will prevail.
Major Andre, you do not have a rosy ending to this war.
I don't have the luxury of an after. My time is very short. I still don't know the means of my execution. I can only hope that I will be, my greatest hope at this point, is to be shot by firing squad like an officer and a general.
Mr. Blackhorn, what will you do when this war is over?
It is my hope that the great father of the English will win this war. And when he wins this war, and the Indian people that come and help, that he shall protect more of our country. He shall make that the sons shall listen to the father, and the sons will grow into men, and we can start a new day with them, for you are children. You are children who do not listen to your fathers. You do not listen to your family, and we are your older brothers. And the older brother must sometimes watch the younger brother fall. And when you fall and you cut your leg, we shall extend our hand and help you rise. We shall help bring you back to the village of your father. But you must extend the belt of wampum that you have laid down and grow into men. And so when the great father of the English, when he wins this war, he shall ensure, and has told us that he shall ensure that all our lands shall be protected. Those that are on the Allegheny, those in the Haudenosaunee, the Haudenosaunee country, and those that we have in Oswego, the Algonquian lands that we still have, that these lands will be protected, and that it is our hope that one day there may be representation for us, that the great father of the English will ask all of the great chiefs who have supported him in this great war to come to England, and he shall talk to them and maybe make us part of his great parliament in England. However, it is my fear that if we lose this war, more of our country will be taken. More of our country, our great country, shall be lost. And we shall not be able to live the way the Creator intended us to. But since the Wanak has arrived, all we have known is change. And change is all that we do know.
Miss Elizabeth, will it matter to the enslaved communities in these colonies, and personally to yourself, which side actually wins this war?
No. I believe that people can say anything and they still will do something else. I've seen that happen many times. I do have hope that one day my people will be free, and the work that I have done for Master Townsend to get secrets to him that he would give to your General Washington, I do have hope that my work will count for something and perhaps lead to my own freedom. And perhaps if the Patriots win the war, we will also gain our freedom. That is my hope, but I don't know.
Captain Gershom Mott, as probably the leading military man in this room here, have you an opinion as to how this war will play out?
I think it's safe to say that the Philipse family doesn't have to worry about their exile in New York City continuing too long. We've spent the winter, though it was a hard winter again for the Army, training in New Windsor, our artillerists learning to launch a siege operation against New York City. General Washington himself has traveled to Newport multiple times to meet with our French allies. I hear even now the French fleet is preparing. We hope to make a juncture with them and attack New York City, though I hear General Greene has had some success in the South with the Battle of Cowpens and the victory at Kings Mountain, along with a pretty well-fought battle at Guilford Courthouse. And even General Lafayette in Virginia surrounded that traitor, Benedict Arnold, with a cloud of light infantry. So perhaps that final battle may be somewhere else.
Hmm. David Williams, what is your opinion of this war and where you expect to be at the end of it?
Well, begging the officer's pardon, he has a perspective on the war on a much larger scale than I do. He speaks of grand maneuvers and a lot of hope. I don't see as much of that here as I would like to. The area here is war ravaged. When you burn somebody's property or burn their farmland, whether they are Patriot or Loyalist aligned, we are deprived of food. We must take time to resow our crops and regrow the land. So even if we come out of this war better, it's going to take some years to determine how well off we will be. But I do have hope personally that I will be able to settle down eventually with this lovely woman whose father I've been helping, and maybe establish a farm of my own one day. And that is the only hope that I have for right now. But it is a lot of ifs that happen.
And where will this farm be?
Currently, South Salem, New York. I have no means to move out west, sir, for right now.
Or north?
As to say, sir, there's a lot of ifs that have to happen first.
Mrs. Knox, will there be a time, do you think, that you and your husband could possibly reunite with your Loyalist family? Do you see that in the future, or what do you see the future holds for you?
I hope that at some point they will return my letters. Perhaps once everything is said and final, they will open their hearts back to me. I have written, but I have not received word. I pray that my brother survives this war, as I do my Henry. I have had the fortune of being at the artillery park that the captain had spoke of, and I saw great training and great things. Our men are ready for this campaign. And my children and I are ready to follow them. We will go where they lead, and it will lead to victory.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I do thank you for this episode of Time Chat. I appreciate your time that you have spent here. For this program, I also will like to open this up to questions, but I would like to introduce our cast because I think it could get really hairy if we kept everybody in character for questions as well. So I will like to introduce everybody. So as Mary Philipse Morris, this is Sarah Wasberg Johnson. John Andre today is, and every day, is Jim Keyes. And Black Corn is Drew Shuptar Ravis. This is performed by Carla Lynn Hall. Yay. And Captain Gershom Mott is none other than Chad Johnson. David Williams is portrayed by Matt Thorenz. And Lucy Flucker Knox and the Flucker family is represented today by Tiffany Downs. And our sign associate, Ms. Dawn That, is Kara Moore. Yay!
And our host, Michael Lord.
I'm Ben Thayer, Michael Lord. So folks, I think the way we're going to do this is that we are going to hand out a microphone to anybody that has a question, and then we're going to pass this microphone around for anybody that wants to respond around the table here. Do we have any questions for the audience?
Oh, thanks, Kara.
Mr. Williams.
Yes.
I understand from what you shared with us that you actually were first in the Continental Army and went to the northern section of the fighting. Is that right?
Yes, I don't want to say one of the first, but yes.
Yeah. And then you came back. I understand that was a horrible experience for those who were in that cold, destructive environment, but you came back and then you joined the local militia, am I right?
Yes.
Have you ever been a member of a ruffian bandit crowd?
Well,
yes, he has. Yes.
Wait!
Depends who you ask.
I'm asking Mr. Williams. He is a patriot who has already served in the army and in the militia. Mr. Williams.
So I'm going to speak as Mr. Williams, but I'll speak. I think it'll be better if I speak as a researcher, somebody who actually did a little bit of research on him. Now, in this area of New York during this period, there was a lot of partisan warfare that was going on.
There was, and there were those who chose to join the militia.
Yes.
And serve the patriot cause and those who didn't.
Yes, yes. So
sometimes they're the same person.
Yes. So, and as we know, you have this no man's land that existed. So in either side, depending on where your loyalties lied, you took advantage of that. And so David Williams, who served originally in the Continental Line up until November of 1775, he actually misses being involved in Quebec, fortunately. Unlike Benedict Arnold, who ends up being captured, and General Montgomery, his other commander, who's killed, he gets sent back. And he reenlists in the local militia, which is what you do. And at that point, he really has no home anymore, because he declares his loyalties are with Continental. So the local militia is where you go. And that was also where a lot of his friends and relations were, too. That was also kind of where he saw the most important, his job at that point was basically being here locally. And as Gershom Mott pointed out, New York City up to this point was strategically very important for for both sides. So if you could align yourself with one of these groups or you were involved in the local militia and you had to do these partisan tactics in order to either instill fear in your neighbors who may have had loyalties with the king or might have been providing the king's troops with food and material. If you were able to kind of root them out, burn their homes down, destroy their crops, forage, whatever, you're really trying to handicap the British Army's ability to actually supply its troops and hopefully bring the war to a speedy conclusion. So it's kind of one of those, it's just to have by the means.
Didn't your new government give the militia the power to, on militia duty, to intercept those who were taking cattle to the enemy in New York City? And wasn't that a very respectable job that you were doing?
I mean, it's all part of the messiness of war.
Well, they certainly liberated a lot of Philipse cattle, yeah. We'll say it that yeah. way.
Anyway, I fear that in the future, instead of getting recognized, there might be those who misinterpreted what you did as, in my opinion, a very patriotic job.
Yes.
And beware.
I think we all know what side Constance Keene is on in this conflict.
And that, and just... so that actually ties into, you know, William's, you know, he is also somebody who is unable to write his own story. So oftentimes he has to promote himself in some way to kind of justify those things. And oftentimes history isn't just written by the winner, it's also written by the person who is able to be the better writer.
And so, I will say, regarding Williams, the person who probably disparages those men the most is Andre's counterpart in the Continental Army, Major Benjamin Talmadge, which it basically becomes almost like a class issue. He's looking down on these guys because they're not officers, they're enlisted soldiers.
In later days, he actually retracted that argument that he made against those men. And here it is. But that's down the road in another time.
Any other questions?
So this question is directed to whoever feels like they would like to answer it. It seems that when you listen to everybody's viewpoint, a lot of it boils down to how wealth is accumulated and how it's defined in at this period in time, and mostly that's about the ownership of land. So who on either side is thinking about, at the conclusion of the war, what's going to happen to land? And is it going to go back to the old system, or is there going to be some kind of redistribution of the land?
So I will answer for the manor lords, right? So the Philipses are loyalist, right? And a couple other, like the Delanceys and some other wealthy families, the Coldens are also loyalist. But a number of the manor lords, the Livingstons, the Van Rensselaers, the Jays, you know, people who are huge landowners who are enslavers, they have tenant farmers, they all side with the Patriots. So there's this interesting dichotomy between, you know, wealth and who's siding with what side. The Philipses, in particular, have a court case against some of their tenant farmers in the 1760s, and they produce, you know, Beverly Robinson produces this deed kind of out of nowhere that says the Wappinger people don't have sold, you know, 50 years ago sold this land. So the crown sides with the Philipses, which is, I think, part of their loyalty to the crown, that the crown is protecting their interests. They are manor lords, you know, they're not just large landowners. They have this distinction from the crown that gives them extra rights. So I think that's part of why they stay loyal. But the other manor lords who are also having problems with their tenant farmers, the crown kind of tends to protect some of those tenant farmers from their manor lords. So I think that is part of the reason why they end up siding with the Patriots. Anybody else want to weigh in?
You want to go?
I'll say for the Continental Army, we're from New Windsor Cantonment State Historic Site, last encampment of the Continental Army. The bulk of our soldiers, you look at where they're buried, they're out in Western New York, the Ohio, you know, that area. At the end of the war, the greatest danger to our independence becomes the Continental Army, because you have created this professional army that thinks very highly of itself, and you have no means to pay it. So how do you pay it is with land taken from the native people.
Well, yeah. There's also issues in the French and Indian War of people who had, you know, fought for the British cause, and part of their pay is, well, you can have a certain amount of land that's not claimed. Well, guess what? All the large landowners have claimed all of the land, mostly in the Hudson Valley, and then the Mohawk River Valley, it's all Iroquois Confederacy. So there is no land for them to get their reward. And so I think that also plays a role, you know, with the land awards for Continental Army soldiers. You're gonna chime in, Matt?
Right, yeah, and I didn't wanna say too much because we were kind of focused on a very specific time frame, but when Blackhorn, Drew's character, is asking me, where do I intend to have my farm? Well, yes, in 1780, he's very much established here, and he ends up living here until 1805. And then David Williams, his wife, I believe her name was her last name was Bishop, and their son, they end up moving out to Broome in Schoharie County. So he does He is one of those people who ends up moving
Iroquois lands.
Yeah, it's the Iroquois lands.
Because a lot of these, so for Algonquian and Iroquoian people, it takes about 1,000 mounds of corn, beans, and squash to feed an entire family of four for an entire year. So if you multiply your average village between 50 to like 100 and something people, a big village might be 1,000 people. That's a massive area of land you need to feed yourself, not only on corn, beans, and squash, but also hunting, fishing, trapping. Because furs are one of the only other parts of economy where you could get trade goods, guns, powder, shot, beads, and alcohol, unfortunately, and other things that people wanted. And so land was such an issue because you had at this period so many communities that were on the eastern seaboard that remnant populations do maintain, and they do stay. They're heavily Christianized, and they intermarry with free Africans and poor whites, and you see a lot of them side with the Patriots. But you see a lot of non-Christianized Indians or Indian peoples living in solid Indian communities that have been displaced. And so you see people that once lived, you know, in the lower mid-Atlantic that end up with the Abenakis in the borders of Vermont and Canada, that end up in Oswego. We actually know from the oral tradition from my community, Pocomoke Indian Nation, what was told to my chief from his elders is that the Pocomoke had gone up the Susquehanna Flats and then to Oswego. And so, for a long time, I thought that's just an oral tradition. That's great. Until I actually looked at Philipsburg Manor's records, and it lists William Johnson listing where the Nanticoke are living, and it's at Oswego. And this is in 1775. So we know that that oral tradition in my community had been around since the 1770s. So for Native people, land was so important because it's how you're feeding everybody. It's not, and it's also your connection to that place and to where you're from. So for our community, one of our traditions is that in the old days anyway, we don't do this anymore, was that when you died and the community had left, it was expected that you would dig up the bones of your people and carry them with you to the next place. This was a custom of the Pocomokes, the Assateague, and the Nanticoke. We also had what were called Muntokump or Keokasin, which is a bone house, which is an ossuary house made for the remains of our chiefs and elders and higher up individuals who were buried. And Heckwelder records, who's a Moravian missionary, he writes about these Nanticoke people going into Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, and he could smell them from a mile away because they were carrying the bones of their dead that still had flesh on them. Because in our tradition, you did not leave your dead. You took them with you wherever you went. And so that land was an incredible connection. And so for Native people at this time, we're already pushed into places we weren't supposed to be in. You know, and I'm sure there was a lot of tension with the Iroquoian groups and the Algonquian groups because they're thousand-year enemies of each other and thousand-year disagreements. And so their biggest concern would be, okay, I've been pushed into the Finger Lakes of New York. Do I really want this guy over there taking more of my land? And I know how hungry they are for land and they know what's in the Finger Lakes. They've seen our cornfields. They've seen our peach trees. And Sullivan's campaign records all this, the thousands of acres of peach trees that were so full of fruit, the trees were falling down. And so Native people were very aware that colonists were desirous of their land, especially because it was already cultivated.
This question is addressed to Liss. Was your slave master, Mr. Townsend, a loyalist or a patriot?
He was a patriot.
So that's why you were a spy for George Washington?
Yes, through him. So Robert Townsend, was his nickname they found later was Culper Jr. of the Culper spy ring. So he was involved in getting secrets information to George Washington. So it's believed that Robert Townsend was able to get Liss to participate because who would expect an enslaved woman to be a spy? You know, there's all kinds of conversations that are had right in front of us, you know, right in front of us, and people think that we don't understand anything, but we, you know, even if we don't read words, we can read people. We have ears, our ears work, and so it ended up being a very a good advantage for him to have, you know, an enslaved person on the team.
And also, according to the Declaration of Independence, you were not in agreement with at that time that you would see yourself in liberty, a suit of happiness? Was it because you were a slave? But you said you were more close to your family, and you're a slave owner that had their family. Some families were disbanded, but how could you not see yourself having some happiness from that Declaration of Independence, although 40 of them were slave owners?
Well, I think that that's actually an answer right there, because even if these words are great, but the people writing those words, they are slave owners, and they aren't looking, they're not doing any kind of work to free their slaves. So I don't think, I wouldn't have believed that it would apply to me. There was nothing that, whatever they were saying, there was nothing that they were doing that would give me any kind of belief that this applied to me. It didn't apply to me. I'm cleaning their stuff, you know? And so I was just going, where's my family? My family is here, and we work for, or we are enslaved to the Townsend family. So I think also, enslaved person, enslaver, the relationships are also very, very complicated. Very complicated, different things that we've read in different documents, that even though there was definitely that hierarchy, there was still that power dynamic, there was still relationships that were navigated. And so different things that I've read in the story between Liss and Robert Townsend, he went to bat for her. There was a time, not to get too far out of the story, but at one point she was sold to South Carolina, and he had joined some manumission society, and he actually did a lot of effort to be able to bring her back, which was actually against the law. Anyway, all I'm saying is,
why don't you tell what happens to her after?
Okay.
That's okay. I don't want to take it up because
All right. So everything is complicated. And so at one point, Liss had escaped to New York City, and she was working as a slave for a British officer. And at that time, after the war ended, there was evacuation day, and the British were going to go back to England. They're leaving. Liss went back to Robert Townsend, and she asked him to buy her back. So he said yes. So he bought her back. So even after she'd escaped his home, because we're not even sure if maybe he was in on it, but he had escaped. She had escaped, and then she asked him to buy her back, and he did that. But he didn't want her he didn't really need her as a slave. He didn't want to have her as a slave. And again, he did end up being in a manumission society, which is, freeing slaves. So we know that he had some feelings about it. So what ended up happening was he ended up selling her to a widow by the name of Anne Sharwin. And the deal was that, I want you to, I'm going to sell Liss to you. And if it so happens that, if you need to sell her, come to me first. So that was the deal that was made. However, Anne Sharwin, she remarried. She had been a widow. She'd been remarried. So what happened was something with her new husband. We don't really know what happened, but he sold her to some person in South Carolina without Robert Townsend knowing. And 2 years later, he found out where she was, and he had to do a lot of work, but he was able to get her back. And because at that time he was in this manumission society, it was illegal to bring a slave back to the North. So he had to find a friend of a friend of a friend to arrange for her to be returned. And actually some of his friends were like, well, I've never owned a slave before. I'm not gonna buy one now. So he really had to do the work to get someone to basically smuggle her back north. So there's just a whole bunch of, so all I say is, yes, there is this enslaved person and enslaver relationship, but there's also a personal relationship that makes things so complicated. So just from that, I just feel like, you know, they've known each other since she was born. She grew up there. That's really where her loyalties are going to lie, not so much whether he's a patriot or a loyalist. Thank you.
I would use the word instead of complicated, compassion. I think Mr. Townsend, as a patriot, not only had compassion on Liss and the slaves and everything that was going on around, because he made such an effort to regain you back.
That, I mean, really above and beyond kind of effort, so I agree.
I have a question for Liss. How was the information delivered to the Patriots? You know, you're a spy. How would you tell the folks? And also another question, was there like a double spy thing going on?
Oh, that's good. That's really good. So maybe. So when Liss was in the household of the Townsend household in Oyster Bay, the British officers basically took over the house. So everybody was living in this house. And while she was friendly, so there might have been, if you think about it, kind of a double spy, because she was friendly with John Andre and John Simcoe when they were there. And it's even written that they thought she was a little too fond of the British officers. So she may have been charismatic, attractive, but she left. She escaped from the Townsend household. And it's very interesting because in the letters, a letter that Robert Townsend wrote to his father, Samuel, they were thinking that it was a cow. So they like, I can't believe that Simcoe let this cow go, this cow named Liss. They didn't realize till later that they were referring to a human. So no, it wasn't a cow. But we also know that Robert Townsend and his father, Samuel, had a pretty good idea where she was in New York City. She was working for a British officer. So the idea was, while she was working for this British officer, Robert Townsend had a shop in New York City. So she would give information. She would hear things. You know, she's working. You know, do 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 do. Oh yeah. You know, she would hear information, and she would pass that information on to Robert, who would pass that on to General Washington. You're welcome.
Sorry, people. I'm going to keep you here all the time.
Oh, yeah.
During this time, what was the general public's understanding of what was going on, other than seeing some of these skirmishes? And how did the information of the Patriots get communicated to speak of what could be a potential opportunity for a change from the existing rules?
Well, I mentioned briefly there was the War of the Pamphlets that was happening down here in Westchester County. And the buildup, and even afterwards, of the British, you know, the revolution, the beginning of the revolutionary period, you have these pamphlets that were being distributed, authored by a Anglican minister in the area. And then you have these rebuttals that are being printed from a patriot perspective. And those rebuttals are actually written by a guy by the name of Alexander Hamilton. So a lot of those pamphlets are being circulated around here, and you think about people like David or other individuals who could not afford the education to learn how to read and write, but where did you get your news from? You got them from attending your church. You would probably have maybe the local minister or deacon, if they were of one persuasion or the other, maybe reading these pamphlets to you, or you'd go to a local tavern and somebody would be reading them to you there, or even your neighbors would do that. The printed word was very big in the colonies at this time. New York City, Philadelphia, Boston, all were big major printing centers. And again, Henry Knox was a bookseller. So news circulated back then through what we would expect today, newspapers. And it was just a matter of trying to figure out which side was telling the truth, because one would be telling it from the Loyalist side, the other would be from the Patriot side.
And there were definitely, the newspapers were partisan. So the Royal Gazette, well, you can guess which side that one is on, right? But there's a long tradition, particularly in New York, of newspapers being very political for one side or the other, so.
Well, folks, first of all, I'd like to thank you for sticking around for so long. One thing I don't want to do is send you back out into the heat, so I do invite you to take a look at the exhibit. If you haven't been here to Philipse Manor Hall in a while, you'll be in for a treat. It's very new, it's very different, very interactive. If you do have some further questions, you know, we're going to just grab something to drink or anything up here, but we'll be happy to chat with you on our way out as well. Thank you so much for coming today. I do appreciate this.